Good morning and welcome to Superintendent Spotlight with Zap and Chris. Chris Rogers leading the show today. Zap is unavailable. And I just want to point out that, Pete, that before we get started, he was all over me making fun of me a couple weeks ago because he thought I was going to miss a show right off the bat. And did I miss a show?
No, I think your streak is okay.
Absolutely. So, just so folks know, on the Zap and Chris show, Chris is now 3 for 3. So, not that we're keeping stats or data or anything.
Although over the summer you weren't here and he was here with Harry, so.
Well, but that wasn't our show though.
Yes, it was.
It was?
Well, it was a hybrid.
Oh, okay.
Harry is Harry Rocks the Superintendent Spotlight is what we ended up calling it.
All right. So it was an amalgam. So I wouldn't have been needed.
Well, we used the logo.
Oh, we did.
Yes.
Okay. Well, whatever. So since we
gotta tease you a little bit.
So our guest host this morning is our Director of Assessment and Accountability, someone who is no stranger to the show, both as a co-host and a guest, Mrs. Denise Rosala. Denise, good morning. How are you on this fine, beautiful, brisk fall morning?
Good morning, Chris. I'm wonderful. It's great to be back at the Technical Academy and see the kids here, and it's just awesome.
It is.
A beautiful day. I'm happy to be your co-host today.
Well, thank you. I'm glad you could join us. And our guest this morning is none other than our athletic director for both Westfield High School and Westfield Technical Academy, Mr. Ryan Dumphy. Good morning, Ryan. How we doing, bud?
Good morning. I'm doing awesome. How you guys doing?
Well,
we're doing great.
Absolutely. And you know, just to echo what Denise said, you know, I've been lucky enough, Ryan, to be at Tech almost every day since it opened. And I got to be honest, the staff is doing a fantastic job. The administration's doing a fantastic job. Our nursing staff has been absolutely incredible. But the kids have been phenomenal. The kids have been phenomenal. They are following, you know, everything we're asking them to do pretty much to the T, you know, thus far. So I'm really, really pleased with what I'm seeing so far. So, hey, and we've got phase 1B coming up next week. We'll have kids in almost every school except for a couple. So we're moving. So speaking of moving, Ryan, tell us all about fall sports as we open up the school year. And it's not exactly fall sports as we remember it, is it?
Well, you know, so we started Friday with the first practices. It was just exciting. I went around to all the different programs and I said to everyone a few things. I said, one, this is amazing because I didn't know if we were going to get here. First of
right,
all, enjoy
absolutely.
It. Yeah. Enjoy it. Love it. Embrace every moment of it, but do everything that you can to let's keep it right. And you know, kind of to echo your talk about WTA students and doing everything right. You know, the same thing with the athletes, you know, I said, let's do everything right to try to allow this to occur for as long as possible. So far, they've been great. It's just exciting. And we open up with golf coming up on Friday for our first match. And
so
then,
we have a match tomorrow. Westfield High Golf has a match tomorrow. Nice.
It's crazy. Yeah. So normally what we get done in about 2 months worth of scheduling in February, we got done in about 2 days this year. So.
Yeah, we know that, right?
I was going to say, Rogers, we're no strangers to that.
We know those timelines,
but
are really fast and furious.
Exactly. But I'm glad you brought that up, Ryan. Why don't you tell our listeners, you know, what sports are we kind of rolling with to kick off the year? Why did we choose those? And what might be our plan if things start to go a little bit better?
Yeah, I mean, so we have almost all the sports participating right now. So, you know, we have golf, gymnastics, cross country, field hockey, girls volleyball, boys and girls soccer. So all those sports are gearing up to go. We're hoping if things go a little bit better to bring back some practices for football. So that's where we stand right now. So, you know, almost everything's gearing up to go. So it's working out well so far. We're just all crossing our fingers and holding our breath. To make sure that it continues.
And one of the things you brought up, you know, piggybacking on how we started the show, was that the student athletes seem to be rising to the occasion because I think they realize, you know, what happened last spring where we shut everything down and we had no sports. I mean, we lost basically an entire sports season. This summer, we were fortunate enough in the city of Westfield to run Westfield Little League, Westfield Babe Ruth. We did have some baseball going in the summertime, and there were some travel teams as well participating. But now that we're back for interscholastic athletics, the MIAA is basically said, here's what you can do, but here's how you have to do it. So you know, you mentioned the kids. How's the coaching staff been? How supportive have they been in this endeavor?
So, as you guys know, as administrators, you're only as good as your staff, right? So what I have for in terms of fall staff is amazing. And so a lot of returners, a lot of veterans. So with that, you're allowed to trust them. And so they've a lot has been put on them in terms to read all of those modifications, understand those modifications, which is no small feat, I will say. And to relay those modifications to all the athletes for them to follow. And so they're doing awesome at it. They're experienced coaches. And so that really helps us. If we had a bunch of new coaches, I'd be lying to you if I said I wasn't nervous last Friday. And I'm still nervous, but being so experienced.
This is so new to everyone though. So in the nervousness, it's okay because you're doing things that, you know, is new to everyone. So we were talking just the other day about it's okay to make some mistakes here and there, you know, and be flexible. But, you know, it's just completely different sports season than you've probably ever have experienced and hopefully will never experience again.
I know. But you know what? They're doing an awesome job. And I think I feel comfortable with all of the coaches. They're doing great, and I'm hoping it continues.
I'm going to make an assumption because, and even though we're not really supposed to do that, but I'm going to let you follow it up. I'm sure our parents and guardians and our community has been incredibly supportive of what we're trying to do at the high school and the academy for launching fall sports, knowing that it's a different world and that there are things we have to do that are not the norm. Tell us about your interactions with families, the feedback you've gotten, and where we're at on that front.
You bring up an awesome point because people keep bringing that point up because they're a little nervous. They're like, well, how's everyone taking it? How is there a lot of negativity going around? And your assumption is absolutely correct. It's been awesome. It's been positive. I think for two reasons. One, they know the coaches and the coaches have been around here for a while, so they trust the coaches. But for two, I think they're grateful that their kids are able to be doing something. And so I've experienced nothing but positive.
As family members, it's really hard because normally you could take, you know, 4, 5, 8 people to a game, be able to enjoy it. And with all the restrictions and everything, you're limited. But, you know, as a parent myself and, you know, you have children, you know, Chris, you want these students to get what they deserve in playing their sports. And it means so much for them. And it builds such skills that taking that away from them, we know has been really hard. So we're very excited to have the ability to have these students being able to play sports.
No doubt. And Ryan, you said you used the word trust, which is huge. And I think that's where we are with everything right now in our district is there has to be a level of trust and mutual respect and communication between the schools and the home. And that's it's always been that way, by the way. I just want to say it's always been that way.
Right.
But now more than ever that, you know, when we say it's okay for our kids to come back to school and the school committee approves it and the health department says, yeah, we're okay for this group at this time to come back. That's legitimate. That's the truth. And we're using data to drive decision-making. So for us to say that we can run a fall athletic program in the midst of COVID-19, there needs to be a level of trust and support because, you know, we are going to do things a little bit different. Are there any sports that might look different once we actually start competing?
You know, I would say the sport that's going to look the most different is field hockey because they're going to a 7v7 format. So it's almost like they're going to be shifting like regular ice hockey, you know, because it's going to take a little bit more energy to cover that much field. So field hockey will certainly look different. And there's certainly been a lot of talk about soccer being different. I think it's going to look a lot more like soccer than people are assuming.
What's the changes there, Ryan? I with soccer, we've talked about that before off the air, but did the MIAA make soccer some rules to reduce maybe contact with the ball or hands or with each other? What was the rationale? What did they put in place?
So they put in a few modifications. So there's no corner kicks. There's no free throw or not free throws.
Throw-ins.
There's no throw-ins. All throw-ins are indirect kicks, which means they just put the ball on the ground and they play it, on the ground. They're trying to get the ball to stay on the ground because one, that reduces contact with other players. And they're getting rid of head balls. Again, trying to keep the ball on the ground, I think, is key for them, because if you can keep the ball on the ground, it allows you to space out properly. And, just like everything else, they're looking to keep that spacing.
Well, not only that, for those of us that know anything about soccer, that's kind of how the game was designed, was to keep ourselves spread out, keep the ball on the ground. I love hearing that we're reducing head balls, because that means we're also reducing concussions,
which we know that's not a good thing.
So that's like that's a win. Why don't we just keep these rules going forward? Sounds like a win-win to me.
Yeah, so thank you, because everyone keeps saying it's not going to look like soccer. I'm going to Well, many people will argue it's going to look more like soccer.
Absolutely.
With these rules than it has in the past. I think it'll be fast. I think it'll be free flowing. I think soccer will be great.
Absolutely. So just to recap, we've got boys and girls soccer at Westfield High School. We have boys and girls soccer here at the Academy.
Yeah.
We have cross country here at the Academy, cross country at the high school. We have golf at both schools, correct?
Correct.
All right. Volleyball at Westfield High for girls.
Correct.
Gymnastics at Westfield High for the girls. Did I miss anything? Bud, field hockey, you said will be 7v7 at the high school for the girls. Am I missing anything?
I think that's it. I hope so.
I'm just trying to think. I don't want to leave anybody out.
So cross country, golf, right. Gymnastics, volleyball, soccer, and field hockey. And then, I think that covers it.
Ryan, do we have any co-ops going on this fall with anybody else? And can you, or did we put the kibosh on that for the fall season?
No, fall, I'm just double checking in my mind to make sure I'm not forgetting anything. But I don't think we have any co-ops for the fall.
Right.
It's the winter and spring where that kicks in.
Right, right. Okay, good. And for those that don't know, on here, a co-op is when there are a certain set of circumstances that align where students from another school could play an interscholastic sport with our kids when numbers dictate the necessity. So I couldn't remember if we had any co-ops in the fall, which is why I asked the question. So if we've got golf going tomorrow, you said, when do our competitions kick off in earnest?
October 1st.
Excellent. Which, by the way, is not that far away.
1 week.
It's a week. Yeah.
1 week. which is incredible when you think about it, of where we are already in the school year. And I know we started late, but for obvious reasons. But October is that time of – it was always when I was a teacher and a principal, it was that time of year where the honeymoon period was kind of ending and now we were branching out and doing some new things. But this year, October is going to be right in the middle of the honeymoon period, and it's going to be right at the kickoff of fall sports when normally third, fourth week of October they were ending unless there was tournament play. So correct me if I'm wrong, but there's no tournament play this year?
There is no MIAA-sponsored tournament play this year for the fall. So they haven't quite decided anything for winter and fall too, or spring yet. So I don't say anything for certain anymore, by the way. But,
right.
We don't
Welcome
either.
To our world, brother.
Yeah.
Because it's changing so rapidly, and everything does depend on the data and the statistics. So, we're right in not getting anyone's hopes up too high. But we don't want to squash them either, so we just have to wait and see. Take it day by day.
Absolutely. Yeah, but for the fall, there will be no MIA sponsored playoffs.
I'm and not to jump ahead into wintertime, because like you said, nobody knows, but I know that's, when you think about winter sports, with the exception of, and correct me if I'm wrong, but with the exception of skiing, which is, I believe, a club, all of our sports are indoors.
Indoor, yeah.
So for obvious reasons. Like, we're not going to go play basketball in 3 feet of snow outside when it's 5 degrees. So I think that's the next hurdle to get over, and I really hope we get there. For selfish reasons, I love basketball, and I love the winter sports season. And but I also think it'd be, you know, Westfield has such a tradition in sports like ice hockey, for example, and hoops, that it would be a shame if we weren't able to do that for our kids in the wintertime. So I'm thrilled that you know, we're able to at least get the sports season started in the fall.
Yeah, we're just hoping that, you know, we could provide, the fall can provide a good template going forward for the winter and spring, and, you know, hopefully we're in a good place numbers wise and to make it happen. I know they're starting to work right now on getting the committees together to work on the winter modifications to see if this would be possible. So right. They're working on that right now.
Excellent. Anybody that you want to recognize, Ryan, and shout out? And first of all, I'm going to shout you out because you have done a very, very good job with all of this. You've been communicating with
school Stephen, committee, the school committee, out, superintendent,
communicating with me throughout the process, communicating with the health department, just to make sure we're doing it to the best of our ability. And one of the things I keep saying to people throughout this whole thing is, remember, our goal is mitigation and control. We can't possibly make a claim that we're never going to have someone come down with any illness at any time, let alone COVID-19 now. So I think you guys are doing a good job. Your department's done a great job trying to mitigate and reduce the risk and exposure. So pat yourself on the back, number one. But is there anybody else that you want to shout out for their work thus far getting us going?
All right. Well, first of all, thank you. I appreciate that. You know, it's like I said before, it was a sprint in the past week or two, and it's been crazy great, because I love doing it, and it's exciting. But, you know, all of us have been working crazy in the office. Myself, Karen Gomez over at the tech, Jamie Barnes, who probably did about 300 registrations in 4 days with physicals.
I bet.
She's been awesome. Yeah. And Ethan Gamble, our athletic trainer in the district's been providing valuable advice, and, you know, so we've all just been working crazy, but the coaches are the ones that are going to be the important people on the ground, making sure things go well. So, everyone's been great. Yeah.
And just to take a turn for just in a little bit of a different direction, how's our PE department doing so far at the high school, you know, in terms of doing physical education remotely? Because I know as a former PE teacher, that would have been a different animal for me. No question about it.
You know, they're embracing it in such a good way. You know, they're doing so many unique things. Like, they have their own YouTube channel now. They're working on getting as many subscribers to that YouTube channel as possible so they could do tons of things. They have so many videos. It is crazy, the organization and the collaboration that they're doing right now. They're embracing it, and they're having fun. You know, they have their office set up in the gym. It's so all of them are in the gym with their own table, and they're just collaborating with each other from a distance, and, you know, working well. They're doing great.
Awesome. And I know that team up there very, very well. You know, there are some people that are teaching there back from when I was teaching there. So they're doing, and I think you were my student at one point too. Thought I'd bring that up one more time.
Yeah.
So an absolutely outstanding job by the athletic department and the physical education department. Ryan, thanks so much for joining us this morning. Good luck to you. And I'm looking forward to seeing our kids back on the field and on the courts.
All right, great. Hey, thanks for having me.
You're welcome. Have a good day, bud.
Thank you, Ryan. Too.
And folks, it's time for our first break. Superintendent Spotlight, Zap and Chris, except today it's Say Your Piece with Chris and Denise. We'll be right back.
fortune and everything that goes with it. I thank you all, but it's been no bed of roses, no pleasure cruise. I consider it a challenge before the whole human race.
Support for Community Radio on WSKB is provided by Betts Plumbing and Heating Supply Company, an independent, family-owned wholesaler serving Westfield for over 50 years, specializing in plumbing, heating, and industrial piping supplies. On the web at BettsPlumbing.com or at 14 Coleman Avenue in Westfield.
Hi, it's Bob Plass, and I have Wow, It's Tuesday, every Tuesday, 6 to 8. Wow, It's Tuesday.
Community Radio.
89.5 WSKB.
I did it!
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
And we're back with Superintendent Spotlight. It is an outstanding day today, Mrs. Rosales. September 24th, 2020, 9:31 in the morning. We are broadcasting live from Studio 120 at WTA.
It's 63 degrees. It went up.
Absolutely. It's beautiful.
From 59 to 63.
I like
just
it.
The time that we did this half hour
That's
section
right.
of the show.
Broadcasting WSKB and on TV, WCPC Channel 15. And we're about to take the turn and head to the second half of the show, Denise. And who's our guest at this time?
Well, we have Miss Joanne Hetnick. She's the principal of Fort Meadow School, and she's going to talk to us about bringing back our preschool children in the next phase, which begins
Monday.
So we're very excited. Chris, who's coming back on that phase other than we have our pre-K kids?
Right.
Who else is involved coming back?
Right. So Monday, Phase 1B, as the other night at the school committee meeting, the school committee approved Phase 1B for us. So we have our students. That's a big reason why Joanne's here today, is we have our pre-kindergarten students are coming back every single day. We also have some of our high-need students that are in some of our special education programs, such as essential learning skills, developmental learning program, and our autism support program. So we do have quite a few kiddos coming back. In fact, I was looking at it yesterday and having conversations with folks that if you look at it, we're going to have students in every school on Monday except for four. So of the
very exciting.
So right. So very of the exciting. Of the 11 schools in Westfield, seven of them are going to have children, you know, in the confines, the way they were designed.
And we're really, really excited about that. And Joanne is going to talk to us a little bit about what Fort Meadow will look like when those little babies start coming back with their masks. And we have lots of questions to ask. And we're just going to start with Joanne. What will Fort Meadow little pre-K students, what will school look like for them this year?
Oh, good morning. Thanks for having me on. We are thrilled to be having our preschoolers come back on Monday. And everybody is working so hard to get everything in shape at our school to make sure everything is safe. So there are going to be a lot of changes this year at Fort Meadow. So do you want me to just jump right in? And
yeah, why not?
Yeah,
you jump right in.
About safety, what they're going to do, how are we going to get these little ones to wear masks, all those things we want to have answered today on the show.
So above all else, no matter whether it's during a pandemic or any time, children need to love coming to school. And so that has been our goal all along, is to find ways to have our children enjoy school and have fun while also keeping them safe. Not an easy task with preschoolers. Social distancing and preschoolers kind of don't
mix.
That's
a little difficult.
We're working on it. So one of the first things that we've changed is the way that children come into school. So usually children come all through the front door all together. And so this year we are having children go to our side doors off of our playgrounds. Every single classroom we've moved, we've done a lot of work here. We've moved every classroom to our outside classrooms. So we've done, you know, changing around of rooms. So that way, every classroom has an outside door to our playground. So there'll be colored paw prints because we are the Cubs at Fort Meadow. And here's Cubby right here. Cubby's got his mask on. So we had an orientation the other day, and Cubby visited the children and showed how he wears his mask. So we're having paw prints painted onto our sidewalks so people will know where to stand 6 feet apart to be socially distanced. We will be having children enter and exit through those doors. We have cut our program by half an hour. So our program usually is either 9 to 11:30 or 12:30 to 3. This year, it's going to be 9 to 11 and then 1 to 3. And the reason why we've done this is because we need to totally, thoroughly clean those classrooms in between sessions. So all our children are in cohorts. They're all going to stay in their classrooms, except for using the bathroom and going outdoors to play. But we really need to do a super cleaning job in between sessions. So that being said, we are also have really redesigned our classrooms. There's been a lot of furniture moved out. Everything is strategically placed. So children have places all marked where they know where they can sit. And toys have all been separated into baskets. So each child will be able to still go into play centers, and they will get toys in their own basket that they can play with. And then when they're done with those toys, we have special baskets that those toys will go into, and they will be disinfected at the end of each session. So we're really working hard to make sure that we have the physical space ready for the children.
I know that, you know, you've been working really closely with Mr. Rogers, our safety, you know, is overseeing our safety, you know, throughout the district. And that is our first priority. Is the safety
Absolutely.
Of our students and staff, and our custodial staff has been amazing. In these tools, Mr. Rogers was showing me the ioner.
I was just showing Mrs. Rosala the ionizer gun,
and it's like, you know.
Yeah, we have electrostatic sprayers,
it's
basically
amazing.
That are about $2,500 a piece, and they shoot about 25 feet, and they just disinfect
it.
Every single virus and allergen and bacteria known to man, I think. So
you'll be having that.
We have one in every school. So Fort Meadow definitely has.
You just want to get Mr. Poulin to look like a Ghostbuster.
Yep.
That's all.
Right. That's exactly what I thought. Ghostbusters. Yep.
Yep. So we have an ionizer here, and that will be used in between classroom times and at night also. So, and then in addition to that, so there's that whole preparing of the physical layout and making sure children know where they're supposed to be, so they're 6 feet apart. But then you've got the whole reteaching. So that's kind of the really tricky part. So you know, preschool is all about socialization. It's all about learning to share and being kind with each other and having conversation. And so this is, you know, we're having to really do a 180 and go the opposite direction and teach children that you can still be kind. And one way to be kind is by wearing your mask. And then you are, you're a superhero, you're a germ buster. And so,
hey, Joanne, I like that.
I love
it. No, I like that. I think
love
maybe,
it.
Listen, we were just saying Ghostbusters. Maybe we should call our maintenance team now the Germ Busters. I like that.
Yeah,
I like
absolutely.
That. I'm writing that down.
And you know, the preschool kids get it. I mean, it's they see it out in the public, and they do wear their masks. I mean, it's so adorable. You see their little faces and those little eyes, and it's not bothering them as much as like as an adult. We're like,
yeah,
oh, this is so hard, but they're embracing it.
Well, and some are, but you know, parents are very. This is a very hot topic with parents because, as much as some children really like to wear the mask and, you know, they pick out really cool ones to wear. You know, there's other children that just either they, you know, have sensory issues.
Absolutely.
Right.
Other disabilities that they just can't tolerate that. So, you know, we are really working hard. I really stress to parents that this is a skill that we are working on with children. So just like children have to learn how to put on their coat and zip it up. We're
correct.
Working with children on how to wear a mask and the importance of masks. The thing that everybody has to remember that we have at school that you don't have at home are peers. So people talk about peer pressure and how it can be in a negative way. But
modeling
Meadow,
peer
opposite.
In a positive way.
When you go and you celebrate everybody for wearing their masks and giving out brag tags, I wore my mask today, then, you know, the power of peers, when you see everybody else doing it, you want to do it too.
Oh,
so, you know, we've got some tricks up our sleeves. So we're ready.
You always do at Fort Meadow. Yeah. I'm always amazed at the first day versus like the first month, the difference in the things that take place between those times. You've got amazing staff. You know, you're an amazing leader, and you know that you do amazing things with our children.
Yeah, and you know, and just to go back about the whole piece with the masks, and look, nobody likes to wear a mask. We can sugarcoat it any way we want.
Yeah.
You know, I know Denise said they looked adorable in it. You know, I'd much rather see their whole face.
I know.
You know, but with that said, this is one of those things that is a temporary thing. Now, we don't know how temporary it is. It could be another year or so, but the bottom line is we will at some point get to a society where not everybody is covering half their face all the time. But in order for us to make our schools as safe as possible, and that's at any level from pre-K through our seniors here at the Academy and eventually at Westfield High School, everybody's got to be on the same page with this. It's not an if and or but. It's a must do, not an option. Now, you did mention there are going to be some kids that might have some disabilities or some pre-existing medical conditions.
That's right.
Where wearing the mask all day, every day is not going to be feasible, and we may have to find an alternative face covering. But the bottom line is we still need to keep them safe, and we still need to keep everybody else safe too.
Right. And so we're working closely with the nurse. We're working closely with behaviorists and medical doctors. We're all working together as a team to take the right approach for each child. The majority, this is not going to be a problem. In fact, we've actually added more outdoor time to our schedules.
Great.
So typically, we would spend about 15-20 minutes. Now it will be about 30 minutes that children will be outdoors. So, you know, you think about that, a quarter of our time that children will be at school, they're going to be outside playing.
Love it.
So, and we will have spots where children know that they can be, and that will be where they can have their mask break. So if you're, you know, if you're hanging out in this area, you can be socially distanced, 6 feet apart, and have your mask off. So that's how we intend to go and give children mask breaks. But we've got a lot of things that we're adding to our playgrounds. So, and you know, it's great. Children love being outside. And so we're going to make more learning centers actually out on our playgrounds.
which is you know, in light of all, the COVID and the pandemic, some real positive things
absolutely
have taken place for our schools, and that's one of them. The outdoor play,
no doubt,
the nature, you know, those are good things that are socially and academically really positive
absolutely
for our students. So, you know, I think we do have to reflect on it. Has really made us reflect on our educational practices and improve them. Not that we weren't, you know, heading in that direction, but
right.
There's a lot of positive that has come out of this.
And Joanne mentioned mass breaks, and I just want to reiterate the importance of those for anybody, teachers included, by the way, principals included, by the way. We all need nurses. We all need mass breaks. But I also want the public to know there's no limit on the amount of mass breaks we can give students based upon developmental appropriateness and age. And so if you wanted to do, we tell people all the time, if the schools want to do multiple mass breaks throughout the day, we are fine with that. That is not, as long as the kids are socially distanced right when we're doing it and we're outside if we can primarily, that's the goal. So there's no minimum requirement for,
right,
or maximum
or if
requirement
you have a student who you know is becoming agitated or needs that, you know, you take that student out and
that's
allow
right
them to have that, you know, individualized, they need a mask break, you know, and they'll communicate that to you. I mean, that's the goal, that children would communicate that to us to inform us that, you know, I can't stand this anymore. I need to go out and take this off and get some fresh air and that. So that's part of the preschool is learning, you know, all of those social skills and, you know, being able to communicate to their teachers and their peers. So, yeah, it's a challenge. It's a challenge.
Yeah. And so one thing we've done, we use a lot of picture icons with children because we don't always want to be talking at them. Put your mask on, put your mask on, keep your mask on. So we've done some ways that we can go and really work on that skill with children. And one is through picture icons. So all of our staff have lanyards that have different picture icons just to help add gentle reminders to our children. So now we've added a little face that has a mask on it. So just a little reminder without having to use our words. And that will do the trick for a lot of kids. We have social stories where, you know, oftentimes we forget that, you know, children really get it. And if you explain to them why we are wearing a mask, and of course, in simple terms, so we have stories about, you know, that you are being a germ buster and you're being kind to others by wearing your masks. And so we're really going at it at a developmentally appropriate level. Also finding games. This is a huge thing for, of course, older children understand what 6 feet is. When you're little, they have no idea what that means. So, you know, it's up to the adults to go and find games where we can play these games, whether it be Simon Says or other things, that children are spread apart 6 feet automatically. And we have those spaces marked for them so they know. One thing that's really exciting that we're adding to our gymnasium is a sensory path. So what a sensory path is, and those of you who go on Facebook, this was really all over Facebook probably about a year ago. And they're just really neat stickers that go on the floor. So it might be logs and it might be a frog, you know, with lily pads. And so the children go through, it's kind of like an obstacle course. And they go through and they, you know, jump on the logs, or they might tiptoe on certain areas. And it's really cute, it's fun, but it's a great way to separate children, and they're playing and having fun without sharing toys, and they're being, you know, separated, but still having a great time. So that's something else we're adding.
Well, that's amazing. It sounds like you have had a very busy time, really, with, you know, thinking about all those safety precautions and ways to get the mm-hmm. engagement and that. Talk a little bit about your teachers and staff and what they're doing and their excitement for receiving the children next Monday.
Well, One thing that I want to also stress too is that we don't want to forget about all these children that are learning remotely. So we have about 30 children who have chosen to learn remotely.
Oh yes.
What does remote look like with a preschool child?
Right.
That's got to be a challenge and a half to Absolutely. Get them to sit in front of the screen.
It needs to be fun and dynamic. And, you know, we're making props to send home with children so they can participate, because waiting your turn is hard enough, but waiting your turn while looking at a screen is not great. So there's going to be a lot of interactive activities that they can be doing. But along with that, staff, you know, of course, 2 weeks ago, everybody was kind of frozen, you know, just worried, sick. And it's sure. because
it's new to
it's
us
because we care so much and we want to do such a great job. And we do. But, you know, like I told them, it's like being a new teacher all over again. We know what to do. We know how to teach, but now we're under different parameters. So now, you know, now that we've really gone through, you know, the cleaning process that needs to be followed and how that's going to happen, what we're going to use for that, those cleaning, how we're going to design our classrooms, and, you know, we're going to move the children around and give them their own sets of crayons and markers. And, you know, now that everything's coming together, you know, before it was all just talk and this is what we think we should do. Now it's finally all coming together. Not going to lie, it's going to be a busy next 2 days painting paw prints on our sidewalks and all kinds of stuff. We're very, very busy still. But even when we did this week, some orientations and meet and greets, and just seeing, for me, just seeing those children on the screen, it was like a whole brand new day. You know, a lot of this for everybody has been too much, and you get weighed down. You know, you just feel, you could feel your body sinking.
We miss our students.
Yes. And whether you're an adult or you're a child, but just seeing those little faces waving at you and so happy to see you and so excited about coming to school, it's all going to be wonderful. We get them here. Once the kids come, that's the start of every school year. You work for this day. And once the kids come, whether they're on the computer or they're coming in the door, then it's all just the way it's supposed to be. And it just is great. So thrilled.
Well, and what's really nice about phase 1B, and I think we did say this already, is it's not the preschool by design always had a cohort. Right. We talked about this a little earlier. There was always a cohort that came for the morning session and a cohort that came for the afternoon session. So not exactly business as usual, like we've elaborated on, but there is a similar format, you know, to the schedule of the school and how it's going to look with the kids returning every day, where that's a clear advantage over the rest of the district, with maybe the exception of the school we're in right now, Westfield Technical Academy. Everybody else is going to have all these cohorts and all these different designs, but Fort Meadows kind of, you know, it's going to look a little different, but going to be a little shorter, going to be some more time outside, people wearing masks, but the cohorts are already kind of, you know,
So. And that's what preschoolers need the most. They need to have structure. They need to know what's happening next. So the best thing that we can do, and you know, the superintendent and all of the central office staff were so supportive. The state has made it very clear, all preschoolers, whether they have disabilities or not, are high needs in the high needs category.
Of course, they are.
Because the 3 and 4 mental level, they're developing so quickly.
Right.
So everybody has worked so hard to make this happen, so that way children can be coming to school every day.
Yes.
And that is going to make a world of difference for everybody.
Well, no question.
You know, as educators, we know that pre-K to 2, that foundational knowledge is so important. And, you know, the longer we keep them away from schools, the gap is just going to grow wider. This is the right thing to do.
Yeah.
And we can't wait till we get all the kids back.
Absolutely.
And, it's been very hard for us as administrators to even phase them in. We know it's the right thing to do, but it's, yes, we want our kids back.
Well, Denise, you said it. I mean, you hit the nail right on the head. The pre-K to two, it's that old house metaphor, right? You don't start by building the second floor. You know, you start by, you know, laying
building
the foundation.
Foundation.
You know, and that's the foundation of everything we do in public schools. Starts with our youngest kiddos, and you look at all the data and you look at all the research that's out there. It is imperative that our kids learn how to read by third grade. I mean, it is a predictor in so many ways of future success or failure.
Yeah.
So it is imperative that the kiddos in these age groups are back in school as soon as possible. So, no question. Joanne, anything else you'd like to add about the fort before we wrap the show this week?
Let's see. Just that we're really looking forward to. One thing is that we do have we have our Facebook page, so people can be looking for updates on our Facebook page. We also have our own YouTube channel at this point.
Right.
So we will be making use of that, because with children, repetition is great. So if we have, we've already had Mrs. Solar and doing her sing-along on there, and children, you know, just love to watch it over and over again. So many of our lessons will be available on that YouTube channel. And so children can watch it, you know, however they want.
That's a wonderful idea, because like you said, if they can go back and rewatch, because we all know they need to hear and do, you know, sometimes 20 plus times to be able to master that skill or whatever. So just the fact that they could go back, you know, in the evening with their parent and review and look at that is really great. To me, that's the positive that has come out of the COVID is, you know, our teachers have really risen to the expectations of remote learning and digital learning, and really they're taking on challenges and doing more than they've ever done before with technology, and you know, they just have to give themselves permission sometimes to let it go. And it's like, we're not going to be perfect the first time. I mean, first time we did our Zoom and Google Meets, I mean, we were like, how do we mute? How do we figure this out? And we're administrators. So, you know, we just want people to embrace this time. We know it's, what do we say, flexible, being adaptable and flexible.
Absolutely.
And just make kids, like you said at the beginning of the show, want to be engaged in school with us.
Right.
You know, that's our most highest priority for us
really
right
is.
Now.
Absolutely. And I know I hit on this a little bit earlier when we kicked off the show, but I want to reiterate it again. There is a group of staff members that doesn't always get there are a couple groups of staff members that really don't always get shouted out or don't get the trumpets blowing for them, you know, but in this particular time that we're in across the district, there are certain groups that I really want us to recognize, from the preschool all the way through the high schools, and that's our maintenance team, right off the bat. Our custodians are doing a fantastic job. I want us to shout out our nursing department. The nurses have been working at warp speed, and they've also been an incredibly collaborative group working and being a support for each other. Let's not forget that we have food service staff that are also working.
Rachel's been working hard with her staff all summer long, and you know, throughout the spring with feeding our families
and
students.
Let's not forget our transportation department led by Pam Katarski, because we, even though we have all these regulations, we still have a very big area of a city area wise, square footage and square mileage wise, and we do need to get our kids to school. And that they're working overtime and doing a fantastic job. And I know that's all going to be in play come Monday at the fort. We got to get our kids there. We got to feed them, right? We got to keep the building clean.
Can I add a couple more, Chris?
Sure. Secretaries?
So one would be definitely the technology staff.
Yes.
The technology department We've had a lot of glitches this week.
Yes.
And I know across the district, we've had a lot of glitches. And I so appreciate parents' patience. But then the other piece is our office staff.
Yes.
And our secretaries, because who do you call when things go wrong?
The front line.
The first person that answers that phone is the secretary. So,
right.
And there have been a lot of calls this weekend.
Oh, I'm
and
sure.
It's been very challenging. So, I think we need to add those folks to the list to give a shout out to.
Definitely.
And I think I want to also shout out our principals and you, Joanne,
sure.
as well as all our other principals, because, you know, you've worked very hard behind the scenes and have really been getting it from multiple ends, from the teachers, from the administrators, from central
right.
office.
There's not,
you know, and you're, you know, like you
so
said,
hard.
You're pulling things together
right.
And making it look seamless. You know, I have no doubt that Monday when those children come to the
yeah.
front door and their doors, you know, it's going to look magnificent. And the work behind that
sure.
to get us to that point was immense. So
yeah,
you know,
a lot of long
days and
us,
nights and
sure.
and thank you for that. We really appreciate it.
Thank
well
you.
Again, thanks for being on the show this morning, Joanne. We're looking
You're
forward
welcome.
We're looking forward to Monday. I know I'll be down probably tomorrow morning to just do one quick last walkthrough, and I think some of us will be down on Monday
to give a hand
for sure,
because it's always the highlight
yep,
of our year.
Absolutely. So with that
socially
said,
distance, I won't hold the children's hands because now,
right?
Oh boy.
So with that said, take some time this weekend, relax. You earned it, and we're ready to rock and roll at
ready.
Fort Meadow on Monday morning. Mrs. Rosala, any last words for our viewers this morning? Or
no,
viewers
just,
and
no,
listeners?
No, just thank you, Mr. Rogers. It's always a pleasure to co-host with you.
Well, thank you.
I mean, we work right, you know, our doors are right near each other at Central Office.
That's right.
But it's always enjoyable to come and have the guests in and do the show with
well,
you.
Well, thanks for being
I'm
here.
Happy to be here.
And folks, that's gonna be a wrap for Superintendent Spotlight. We will see you in 1 week. Enjoy the weather. Have a great weekend. Go Yankees and Giants. Take care.
You put your right foot in, you put your right foot out, you put your right foot in and you shake it all about. You do the hokey pokey and you turn yourself around. That's what it's all about.
Left foot.
You put your left foot in, you put your left foot out, you put your left foot in and you shake it all about.
You do the hokey pokey and you turn yourself around. That's what it's all about.
Right arm.
You put your right arm in, you put your right arm out, you put your right arm in and then you shake it all about. You put your left arm in, you put your left arm out, you put your left arm in, and then you shake it all about.
You do the hokey pokey and you turn yourself around. That's what it's all about.
Right elbow.
You put your right elbow in, you put your right elbow out, you put your right elbow in, and you shake it all about.
You do the hokey pokey and you turn yourself around. That's what it's all about.
Left elbow.
You put your left elbow in, you put your left elbow out, you put your left elbow in, and then you shake it all about.
Head.
You put your head in, you put your head out, you put your head in, and you shake it all about.
You do the hokey pokey and you turn yourself around. That's what it's all about.
Right hip.
You put your right hip in, you put your right hip out, you put your right hip in and you shake it all about.
You do the hokey pokey and you turn yourself around. That's what it's all about.
Left hip.
You put your left hip in, you put your left hip out, you put your left hip in and you shake it all about. You put your whole self in, you put your whole self out, you put your whole self in and you shake it all about.
You do the hokey pokey and you turn yourself around. That's what it's all about.
Backside.
You put your backside. backside in, you put your backside out, you put your backside in, and you shake it all about. You do the hokey pokey and you turn yourself around. That's what it's all about.
Hokey pokey.
You do the hokey pokey.
The hokey.